name's Andy Hammerlink. I'm a volunteer with the Green Party of St. Paul, and I helped organize this event. Originally, we conceived this as an event solely to commemorate the first meeting of the Green Committees of Correspondence, which took place here at Macalester over August 12th through the 14th, 1984. As it turned out, it was sort of difficult to track down a lot of the attendees at that first meeting. We did find a couple, but we also found some folks that were active early on in the both in the committees and also early on in the Green Party. And so we've invited a few speakers to come kind of share moments from the early years tonight. So some of what you'll get is about that first meeting, and some of it is about kind of early days of green activism. That's also reflected in the memorabilia that's on display here. You'll see posters from the German Greens from the late 70s and early 80s. You'll also see memorabilia from largely from the state of Minnesota Green Party throughout the years, a lot of candidate buttons. These are from a number of different collections of Greens around the state. Diane Peterson, Amber Garland, Rhoda Gilman, and especially Patty Hurd, who's got a rather large collection of Green memorabilia, displayed a lot of what you see here tonight. And Patty's also a collector. She wasn't able to be here tonight, but she wanted me to mention that she's always looking to buy more Green Party stuff. So if you see fit to get in touch with her, her cards are over there on the table by a couple of buttons. So there's food over there on the table. Help yourself. There's also coffee. That's all I have. So with that, I'm going to introduce the MC for tonight. He's a member of the Minneapolis City Council. He's been on the City Council. Cam, is this your third term or your second? This is his third term that he's now serving in South Minneapolis. And Cam's been active since the early to mid-90s with the Greens in Minnesota. So he may have a couple of things to share himself from the early days, but he'll also be introducing some of the speakers here tonight. So without further ado, Cam Gaard.
Well, thanks, Andy, and I appreciate the opportunity to be here. It's pretty exciting to think about the history of the Greens, and I'm sure we all have stories of our own that we could tell. It was either my father or maybe it was Isaac Newton who said, "We see further because we can stand on the shoulders of those who came before." And I think we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the people who did some of that hard work getting us to this point. Of course, the Greens came to existence because there was things like the anti-war movement, the feminist movement, the environmental movement, and I'm probably forgetting a lot, and they were converging and people knew there had to be change. So there were people who came from way back. It would certainly be fun to hear everybody's story, but we've selected some that we want to hear from who have a story to tell that goes back, we think, a little bit further than others, because we wanted to hear more about that. And as Andy said, we really couldn't reconvene the same group that got here in 84, but we have some people who were here and can tell us the early stories about the Green Committee of Correspondence, probably some tensions that happened that are still going on now. Are we supposed to be political or action, electoral? Are we pure? Are we pragmatic? What does it all mean? And maybe this can help guide us as we start thinking about the next steps throughout the conference, where we go. The first person I'd like to introduce, and I'm actually going to introduce a team. I guess they go together. It's Jay Hanson and Jane Leavers from Pine County. And they weren't here in 84, but they were active in the very early stages of the Green Committee of Correspondence, and we'd like to hear from them a little bit. Jay?
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this wonderful celebration. It's just great to see you all. We started in the early 80s in rural Minnesota, and we managed to attract a lot of attention from the Twin Cities people and our local community, and it was great. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm not really a mic freak, I guess. Can I pick it up?
You can move it a lot closer to it.
Well, okay. Does it work?
Yeah. Hello, everybody.
So anyway, as I was saying, we're in rural Minnesota.
And I've... Again.
Hello. Okay. It's heavy, though. How do you do that? Oh, my God. Now I'm going to have to tap dance. It could get bodacious up here. We do like to dance for exercise out in rural America. Yes, we do. So anyway, back in the early days, we basically were able to attract the people based on it being an environmental group. There we go. I think I'm finally kind of got something there. At any rate, we started early in the 80s as an environmental group. But I will say that our biggest debate after that was political party or environmental group. And that debate lasted a long time. We had accomplished a lot of things in rural Minnesota. We were the first organization to ever have stopped the Air Force from using our sky for practicing war against Russia. We exposed Williams Pipeline for polluting our groundwater. We got petitions going and stopped the DNR from owning lakes anymore, which kills everything living in the lake. So as a green group, we did a lot. And then we sort of fractured off a little bit, and we're hoping for a political party, and we worked for a very long time on creating a platform. And I feel that we were very successful, and I'm glad to see so many people here. And in any activity, there is the waning, the coming and the going, the regaining your strength and the energy. That's probably key in any activity that you get in. You have waves where you feel motivated and you feel passionate and the subjects come up. But I will tell you, in my life of 47 years of activism, I have never seen the convergence that we're all dealing with today. We have more issues facing us that I can't tell one person, what should you do? There was a time in the 80s I could say, we need to work on this issue. This is local. One of the things I love about the Greens is the idea and the concept of bioregionalism, work in our own backyards, local produce, local economy. We've all been staying in that all these years. I've lived up there for 37 years, and there's so many wonderful grassroots people up there. And it was great because many of you came up there and worked with us together. And so I guess I would summarize it to say that I have not found another vehicle like the Greens. I love the 10 pillars of the idea and the concept of what a Green is. But I also am concerned. I'm concerned because there are so many third parties out there, and we need to start speaking to each other. We need to find our common grounds and gather up and find what we have in common and go from there, so we have a chance as a third party to actually put a dent in what's going on out there. I'm not a Republican, I'm not a Democrat. I was a naturalist, a humanist, anti-war, a pacifist. Started several co-ops that are still running successfully in the Twin Cities, so I've always had a grassroots background. I want to keep it. So cheers to all of you for stepping out of the box, for thinking, for being motivated enough to come here, for getting on a train, a boat, a plane. I don't care what it is you do. But the one thing we have to stop doing and stop doing now is talking. We have to get out there and do something. Talk to your neighbors. Talk to the guy at the gas station. Talk to your daycare provider. So there you go. That's my message. Keep rolling, baby.
Well, this will be kind of short and brief, but
in the mic?
It's not working. It's not working.
Well, I don't even need a mic, really. I think I can project. Can you hear me all over this place?
Sorry.
Is he coming to help?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Plug it in.
Oh, no volume?
My background is no different than most of the people in here. There's nothing special about really what we did or what I did. I'll speak in the first person there. It just occurred to me when I picked up a newspaper someplace. And he told a story about what was going on in Germany. And they were talking about a Green Party, and it sounded kind of interesting. I just had an initial reaction to that. I said, they're really talking about me. I picked up on it immediately. I didn't even have to know much more about it other than that there was this movement forming in Germany. And so that was just a very humble beginning, but I was Green for many, many years. Before I had a name for it or a label to put on it, as most of you saw over the war. So my story is simple, and we just basically all got together and tried to do homesteading and tried to do sustainability and tried to do organic lifestyle. We tried to live a peaceful existence and be compatible with our community and our neighbors. Some more successfully than others. Jane Lee had a really good ability to be able to connect like that. I was more of a save the woods guy kind of guy, but well, it's been kind of nice. I wanted to come down here today because also it, what she was saying mirrored my feelings exactly. Is that if we're going to ever, we've walked the green for 25 years or 30 years or whatever it's been.
30-some.
Yeah, yeah. And before that, we were involved in the committee for correspondence somewhat. It was pretty loose. But the thing that I wanted to bring to this group, and this is just a very, very important, I think, is that if we're going to re-win huge support from my neighbors and the electoral people of this country, you know, the focusing of the issues on geopolitical areas right now is tantamount and very extremely important. Everybody is concerned about the wars breaking out all over the world. And this is a centerpiece, one of the 10 key values is basically nonviolence. And I don't hear people wanting to talk too much about that issue. And it's not like it's a driver. But we somehow got to get into the streets, and we've got somehow to be able to bridge and communicate with other political parties. Not necessarily in one, you know, in one progression or another, like I'm saying, going all the way across into the right. Libertarian people, they're anti-war, most of them, you know. We've got to figure out how to build some of these alliances. Hey, Michael, how are you doing? I understand. Well, that's one of the reasons why I came out here. I just wanted to see what the temperament was of the people that are going to be here, and whether this is something that's going to be talked about. I think social issues, it's very important. All these areas, there's a lot of areas of personal interest. But this is something that we've got to really come out of, I think. In my opinion, that's what we should be talking a lot about. What can we do to let people know in America that this is what the Greens stand for? And we're not going to take it anymore. It's all done. So. That's about all I have to say if you want.
Thank you very much. And sorry about the sound. I just want folks to know that the speaker is indeed turned up to full volume. So future speakers should speak clearly and loud and right into the microphone, and I think that'll help too. Next, I want to introduce a longtime Green. Actually, grew up in Minnesota, but did most of his Green work out in California. And he's going to tell us a little bit about the experiences, his early days with the Green Party, and maybe some of the struggles and the growth. He's actually a former mayor of Santa Monica, California, co-founder of the Green Party of California. Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Feinstein.
Okay, can you guys hear me? Because I'll try and be a little bit louder than this microphone allows. I'm gonna talk a little bit about both how the California Party was founded and a little bit about the Nader 96 campaign and how that started, because I was intimately involved in both. I started with the Greens by going to the Findhorn Foundation in Scotland in 1988. And I went to a conference called The Individual and the Collective, Politics as if the Whole Earth Mattered. And there were several speakers from European Green parties there. That's where I got exposed to the connection between spirituality and politics. At that point, before I saw that connection, I thought I was gonna end up on a mountaintop somewhere and meditate for 17 years. That's where I was going, but instead I went there. And at the same time I was there, I read Charlene Spretnak and Fritjof Capra's book about the German Greens. So I was integrating those ideas as I was actually meeting Greens in practice, came back to the United States, got involved in my area in Santa Monica, and you know, as Cam mentioned before, ended up becoming an elected Green, et cetera. So our first national gathering was in 1987, where a lot of people got together. The second one, that was in Amherst, Massachusetts. It's written about in your copy of Green Pages in your packet. I wrote a very long history article there where a lot of this stuff is in greater depth. So the second national gathering was 1989 in Eugene, Oregon. And it was at that gathering that many California Greens actually met each other for the first time. The old Greens, our old Green Committees of Correspondence, we were organized by regions because, of course, we wanted to practice our values, and therefore we rejected the lines of the state. We were bioregionalists, and we were going to organize on a regional basis. So in California, we had a northern region, a southern region, and a San Diego region, because they didn't want to drive up the 405 and deal with traffic and come to LA. But as a result, we had this feeling where the northern California Greens and the Southern California Greens didn't trust each other. In the north, I'm from Southern California, we thought they were all New Agers, and they thought in Southern California we're all leftists, and we couldn't talk to each other, etc. So we get to Eugene, and we have our regional meeting of California and Hawaii people, because that was the old region then, and we started talking to each other, and we found out that we weren't monsters, that we were all just Greens together, and we started talking then about the need to work together on common issues. At the same time that we started thinking about that, the Democrats were working on a ballot initiative, my friend Tom Hayden and others, called the Big Green. And Earth Day 1990 was happening the next year, which was going to be the 20th anniversary of the first Earth Day in 1970. So you've got all this rising consciousness. James Hanson was first making noise about what climate change was going to do to us, but the Democrats were grabbing the green name. And then there was this infiltration group called the Green Humanists, Green Futures, that were sponsored by a wealthy industrialist in Argentina that were setting up fake green parties in countries in Europe, and they had tried to get the green ballot line in California between 1988 and 1990. So we're the real Greens. We're sitting there looking at the situation where the Democrats are grabbing the issue, Earth Day's coming up, these nutty cult people from South America are also setting up fake green parties, and what are we doing? So we got together, we met in Eugene, we had a follow-up meeting in Fresno, and then we set up a committee to go to Sacramento and find out what was involved in actually starting a political party in California. Now, the party movement struggle. Should we be a political party? Do you corrupt yourself by trying to transform the system but participating in the system? These are things that, to some degree, while we still keep those ideas in our minds, we've made the choice to be a political party. But at that time, we hadn't made that choice. And it was deeply divisive about when you get into electoral politics and at what level, et cetera. So when we started our state party, there were a lot of people in California who didn't want us to do it and thought we were destroying the movement. And there were others of us who said, look, those of us who are ready to start today need to start today so that the vehicle is there and ready when the society is ready for it, because it takes a lot of work to go ahead and do that sort of thing. So we had our founding meeting. It went really well. 26 locals voted yes, 4 stood aside, East Bay, Ojai, Fresno, and one other, or maybe it was 27 and 3. First meeting was great. The second meeting, when we got to Los Angeles, all the people who disagreed with it came out, and it was very, very difficult. And one of the things that we grappled with at the time was we had our national organization, the Green Committees of Correspondence, and we thought, well, isn't the political party going to be accountable to the movement? Because that was their idea, that political parties grow out of social movements, so shouldn't the Green Party of California be connected to our committees of correspondence? So we took our 3 regions, we set up a California Green Assembly, and then in a meeting at my house on the day before the LA meeting with Danny Moses, Dan Tarr, a couple other folks, giants in our early days, we realized that it's pointless. There's no connection because there's laws which govern political party, and therefore you can't make a political party subservient to something else. So when we announced the heresy at our next meeting that we were no longer going to be connected in a structural way to the Green Committees of Correspondence, you know, all hell broke loose. It was terrible and we were selling everybody out, et cetera, et cetera. But bottom line is we started the party out of that, and ironically, on the national level, a lot of people said, oh, again, you're killing the Green Party, you can't do this, etc. And, you know, horrible of horribles, we ran congressional candidates in 1992. So not only were we running local candidates, which was theoretically okay, but we were running congressional candidates, which was terrible. But then the national press release from the clearinghouse in Kansas City in November of 92 claimed credit for all of our candidates that we ran and said, look at all the votes that Greens got, et cetera. So that was an interesting little piece. So that's kind of how the California Party started, in response to other people claiming the Green identity, when it was that moment and we had to go for it. And we qualified by registering. We needed about 78,992 people to qualify for the ballot. We got 103,000 people to qualify for the ballot in a 2-year period, which arguably to this day might have been the most intensive organizing things that any Greens have done in this country, because we were getting people, there was nothing on the registration form at the time. They had to just check the box other and write you in green. So now let's jump ahead a little bit. Okay, we start in the early 90s. State parties start to happen. In 90, Alaska was the first one to qualify. In 92, California, Hawaii, New Mexico, and Arizona qualify. In 94, Maine got on the ballot. And now we're kind of going through that. And 94, the New Mexico Greens really had a strong surge. They ran for governor, 10.4%, Roberto Mondragon. Their model of having a really credible platform and running candidates on that had worked really well. And Greg Jan, who is one of our earliest people as well, he goes back to 1985. Greg Jan, Steve Schmidt, who had run for lieutenant governor in New Mexico, and myself came up with this concept paper called a 40-state Green Party, where the idea, we didn't think we can get on the ballot in 50 states. We hadn't run for president yet. But we thought, let's take the New Mexico model by having a platform, and that we might, going into 96, attract a presidential candidate based on that platform. And we didn't know who it might be, so we proposed that at the 1995 gathering in Albuquerque, which the New Mexico Greens used their political capital to convene, because we had started splitting over party movement in a very serious way in the preceding couple of years before that. But New Mexico brought everybody back together. We put out that 40-state Green Party conceptual paper there. The people who agreed with us agreed with us. The people who didn't, didn't. And of course, like any good only child, you know, I went ahead, because, and so did Greg and Steve and I, because the people who wanted to do this did. And at that point, we started thinking, all right, we're going to maybe attract Jim Hightower. He was somebody that at the time we thought might happen. Jesse Jackson was making some noise as well about Clinton is doing this wrong and this is wrong, and maybe he'll get in the race. So what happened then is that in California, we passed a proposal to say that we would be receptive if somebody declares, but not that we can necessarily go ahead and recruit anybody. So then it ends up that we hear that Nader starts to be interested in running. And how do we bridge the gap? How do we bridge the gap? Nader did not want to. Those of you who remember 96, he ran on a $5,000 limit for his campaign. He didn't want to spend any more to that because he didn't want to do FEC filing. He didn't want to be in the lead. He wanted to create a vehicle for the rest of us. So he didn't want to declare himself. He didn't want to be top down. So how do we bridge that gap? We did an invite letter where we got 45 key social movement leaders in California to say, Ralph, if you ran, it would mean this and this and this and this. And we have that now on our national site, which, you know, we can get that link sent around. So we, you know, we put out this letter from all these really cool people saying, if you ran, it would mean this and that. And therefore, and this was Rob Hager, who was one of his staff people, myself and Greg Jan, we put this together. And essentially, that bridged the gap between California being receptive and Nader not wanting to declare himself. And then we had this really interesting dynamic. This was in November of 95, and there was a deadline to be on the California primary. Nader went absent. When it came down to the final weekend, we had a final weekend where he had to say yes, and it had gone for a couple of weeks. And essentially, he had been somebody that people had been asking him to run for years and years, and he never wanted to do it. And, you know, he wasn't going to be one of those politicians. And now suddenly he had to confront the fact that he was going to be a politician, and nobody could find him. And clearly, as we were all speculating, he went through a deep period of introspection about whether or not he was ready to make that sort of change. And we got to late Sunday afternoon. It was my birthday, November 19th, 1995. And of course, this was before an internet, so Greg and I were outside at a payphone in the Mission District in San Francisco, which is where we had our state coordinating committee meeting, where we could go ahead and close the deal. Finally, late in the afternoon, Ralph called, said he was willing to do it, and we went off from there. And he ended up, of course, running for us for president that year. We had our first convention at UCLA. We didn't really have a national party at the time. We had the committees of correspondence, but it really wasn't a functioning political party. So what we did with that convention is we had a couple of hours where beforehand each state went through and told its own story about how they went ahead and got Nader, how he went on the ballot, etc. Then at 6 p.m., first time we had ever been on national TV, other than Nader had been on Phil Donahue, remember, before he got kicked off by being too progressive. Nader was on his show in February once, but we had no other coverage before, and all of a sudden we were on C-SPAN, we were on national TV. Nader did a Fidel Castro-like 2-hour and 20-minute acceptance speech there, and in that speech, and I guess I'm close to my time, I'll just close with this. 96 was the first time that Pat Buchanan had run, and some of you may remember the old "Go Pat, Go" sort of, he'd say one of his wacky, horrid, racist sort of things, and all of his people would chant for him. So we're sitting there on national TV, and we start chanting, "Go Ralph, go, go Ralph, go." And then in this magical moment, which I'm still getting the tingling, Ralph said, "No, it's go we go." And all of a sudden, because he wanted it to be about all of us, and all of a sudden, this whole room, we all started chanting, "Go we go, go we go." And it was geeky, but it was also brilliant. It was brilliant, and it just came spontaneously from him. So, you know, it was like a big group hug of 550 people in that room in UCLA. And what that did for us, and I will just finish with this, what that ended up doing in our growth from fighting over party movement in the 80s was this became a sign to independently minded people around the country that it was time to start putting your energy into independent political parties. Somebody of Ralph Nader's stature, the fact that he did it, and then we experienced a growth curve that went like that for many, many years that didn't really tip off until the difficulties we went through in 2004, both self-inflicted and from the economy. So those are a couple of little pieces, and I would just say, please check out the history thing I wrote in Green Pages as well. It goes into how we started the 10 key values and a lot of other good stuff. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Mike. I was there in 96 at that Go We Go, and I really appreciated you reminding us all. I got goosebumps just hearing about that. It was pretty fantastic experience and a great memory. I actually got involved in the Greens a couple years before that, and in 94. And so that was really significant in terms of my own journey and my building that up. I did think I should take a break here and just apologize. I didn't change when I left work, so I'm on the city council, and so I wear this costume so that I can, you know, get away with more stuff. And as soon as I arrived here, I thought, oh dear, I should have definitely changed and saw all of you, so please forgive me for wearing this. But sometimes those little things can help. Actually, when I first ran, I shaved my beard and cut my hair and everything like that. So there's things to think about if you really want to get into the system. One of the reasons I actually got involved with the Minnesota Green Party in 1994 was because I went to an early meeting. It was actually at the Seward Cafe, if anybody had heard of that. And the meeting was about a founding convention and should we start a Green Party of Minnesota. And I've been very involved a little bit in politics and been trying to make a difference and been frustrated. And it just resonated really well with me. I loved the principles. I loved the fact that it was going to be a party based on ideas and a platform and not personalities. But I have to tell you, I was also very, very impressed with the people that were there building that party and trying to make it happen. And one of the people that impressed me is going to be our next speaker, a professor of English at the University of Wisconsin River Falls. She's co-founder of the Minnesota Green Party and author of Ecological Politics, Ecofeminists and the Greens, which actually documents the Macalester meeting. So I present to you Greta Gaard.
Listening to Mike was kind of like a "this is your life," so I'm wondering if I'm going to die when I walk out of here because that was like, "this is your life." I want to talk about feminism in the four pillars and the 10 key values in reflecting on these early years. During the time that I was involved with the Green Movement in the late 80s and 90s, we expanded our activism from social movement to electoral politics. And that shift influenced the central vision of our movement, which was the 10 key values. Of these values, the four pillars, ecology, democracy, nonviolence, and feminism, were variously defined and redefined. Curious about the shift from movement to electoral politics and participating in that shift myself as co-founder of Minnesota's Green Party, as Cam said, along with many others, Rhoda Gilman, who is here, I traveled the breadth of the United States from Hawaii to Maine and asked questions and listened to Greens across the spectrum of activism and political involvement. And my work can be found in that book, Ecological Politics, which he mentioned. But I also made two grassroots documentaries, which I've uploaded to YouTube. They're grassroots, they're before digital editing and all the bells and whistles of, you know, Gasland and such. But they're 30-minute videos, and they're called Thinking Green and Ecofeminism Now. And they're free and available for anyone to look at. So the resilience of this movement 30 years after its founding here at Macalester is something we could hardly envision. And I am delighted to be here. And so I bring this wisdom from your past about the role and pillar of feminism. From Germany's green feminist co-founder, Petra Kelly, to US green feminists Charlene Spretnak, Janet Biel, Inestra King, Haya Heller, Annie Gackey, Winona LaDuke, many others, we know there's a range of feminisms that have founded, shaped, and advised the green movement. Feminists came to the green movement from their own experiences of activism and exclusion in the environmental movement, in the feminist movement, in the spirituality movement, the animal liberation movement, the anti-toxics movement. Feminists came to the Greens with a vision that understood environmental, economic, social justice, and spiritual issues were inseparable. We sought a movement that was founded on this understanding. These four pillars are co-constituted, mutually reinforcing and inseparable in green politics. Putting our values into practice, particularly in electoral politics, was a little harder. From our experience in green politics, we learned that liberal feminism is not enough. Simply having an equal number of men and women in leadership, men and women running for elected office, men and women officiating at meetings or taking the minutes. Simple gender balance is necessary to enact feminist values, but it is not enough. Cultural feminism is not enough. The view that women bring special knowledge about our ecological connections, or that women are closer to nature, or that women's caring and spirituality differ from men. These views are not sufficient. Ecological feminism's gift to the Greens is our transformative vision of human identity across gender, our view of human identity as fundamentally embedded with nature, fundamentally embedded with our environment. We are co-constituted by our relationships with one another, by the way that we produce food, eat, and work together. Our economic practices value or devalue the labor and gifts of humans, animals, plants, and ecosystems. Ecological feminism is the Euro-American effect to companion the wisdom of indigenous cultures and particularly indigenous women. Here in Minnesota, Euro-American environmentalists have been fortunate to work with the Indigenous Environmental Network, with the Red Lake community, with White Earth, and with people like Winona LaDuke, with Raina Crow of the Northwoods Wolf Alliance, and Idle No More Duluth. And in fact, Raina Crow will be holding a workshop at the Greens Gathering here on Saturday on ally building and on the wolf hunt in Minnesota, and I encourage you to check it out. Her work addresses human trafficking, homelessness, oil production on native lands, and so much more. So this feminist and indigenous feminist intersectional perspective is what makes the four pillars connected, particularly in the areas of democracy and nonviolence. I'm glad someone brought up nonviolence. Participatory democracy. In this electoral system based on representation of the marginalized by the elites, those Greens who make it into the system have to speak with the voices of so many, the voices of water and soil, the voices of factory farmed animals and minimum wage workers, queer and transgendered people, native and white, Latino and black, married and unmarried, housed and homeless. In the 90s, we spoke about the Greens' two-legged practice of working inside and outside electoral politics. And we had some couples, one of whom was an activist outside and whose partner was an elected official inside, so that it was really in our relationships. And this keeps our candidates rooted in and accountable to social movement communities outside while promoting and negotiating to enact an ecological democracy with their peers inside. This helps our candidates be sustainable and resilient, securing their roots in community. Nonviolence is seen not only in the decades of peace activism and present cross-border feminist efforts to bring peace to the people of Israel and Palestine and to stop tar sands oil production in Alberta, Canada, but also in the activism against weapons of violence and warfare, which include not only drones and missiles, but also hormone-disrupting chemicals, industrial waste, and the misery of animals used in industrialized animal agriculture, the deprivation of water from people of Detroit. Economic slavery is a form of violence and warfare against other beings who differ by class, race, gender, species, nation, or age, and its practice has ecological consequences. Sexual slavery and human trafficking are warfare. Nuclear energy, fracking, and oil production are warfare. A green feminist nonviolent vision works to end bullying in the schools and bullying in the fields. It insists on the romantic, meaning, I love this earth, don't you? Romantic notion that we are kin of this earth, bound to one another for our very lives. Our elected green officials have the task of translating this nonviolent vision of kinship into laws. As you move forward in this gathering and go home to continue this rhizomatic infusion of green values and green politics, remember the hard-earned wisdom that feminism is green values. Feminism means social justice, participatory democracy, ecological and economic nonviolence, which, as Winona LaDuke would say, requires the flourishing of all our relations. Thank you for being here tonight.
Thank you, Greta. Next, I would like to introduce Tony Affigne. He is the co-founder of the Green Party of Rhode Island. I don't even know what Tony looks like, so hopefully Tony will approach as I finish the introduction. Thank you. And the co-founder of Green Politics Network. He's treasurer of the Association of State Green Parties. I mean, he was in 1999. And he has represented the U.S. at General Global Greens gatherings. So ladies and gentlemen, here's Tony.
Thank you, Cam, and thank you everyone for being here. Welcome, amigos y amigas, compañeras y compañeros. You know that's Spanish, right? I didn't have anything prepared. This is kind of a last minute substitution here, but I do have some things I'd like to say, and I hope you'll bear with me as I go over a little bit of the same ground that you've heard from previous speakers. I was a Democrat until 1982. I've never looked back. 1982, I ran for city council in Providence as an independent, and I was the only candidate in the history of Providence, which you might know was founded in 1636, whose bumper stickers had my name surrounded by red stars, a whole lot of red stars. That's where I was at that time. 1986, I ran for governor of Rhode Island. I was the last Citizens Party candidate for any elective office in America. 1980, Barry Commoner, 1984, Sonia Johnson, 1986, Tony Affigne for governor of Rhode Island. But it was a lonely vision. It was a lonely quest. There was no party. In about 1988, I started doing research on the Greens in Europe. I wrote a book chapter for a book published in Scotland about the rise of the Swedish Green Party. About the same time, I heard from my friend John Rensenbrink that a meeting was being held in Boston of the Green Party Organizing Committee to begin planning the creation of an electorally active political party along the lines of the German and other European Green parties, the Australian, New Zealand parties. I attended that meeting, and just as I never looked back from leaving the Democratic Party in 1982, I've never looked back since 1990 from being a Green Party activist, organizer, and all around. Good job. In 1992, as Cam told you, I was at the founding meeting of the Green Politics Network in outside Kansas City, Missouri. Now, Mike earlier talked about some charitably, we'll call them tensions and disagreements in the Green Party movement at the time, loosely divided between an electoral and a movement wing. Well, since I'd always been a movement activist who'd also run for office, I didn't actually internalize that split. To me, it didn't mean much because, this probably applies to all of you today, it was clear that the movement and electoral activity were actually two sides of the same coin. They were both vehicles to raise the issues of ecological survival and social justice. And they had different purposes. They were valuable and useful at different times, but one was not superior to the other. In 1992, the Green Party of Rhode Island was founded. Some of you may know Tim McKee, who's currently a delegate from Connecticut, lived in Providence at the time. I had come back from the GPN meeting. I don't know where Tim had come back from, but I was walking down Wickenden Street in Providence, and this was as I was thinking about calling a meeting of a new Green Party in Rhode Island, and I found a flyer on a telephone pole asking me to come to a meeting of the new Green Party in Rhode Island. Tim had put up that flyer, so Tim and I got together, and the two of us organized the first meeting of the Green Party of Rhode Island in 1992. And unlike some of the other Green Parties in the country, our party was founded by the merger of two groups of activists. One was the peace and nonviolence movement, and the anti-nuclear movement, the other was the labor movement. Rhode Island, you might know, is the birthplace of industry in North America, which means by definition, Rhode Island is the birthplace of the industrial working class in the United States. Rhode Island is, in many ways, the birthplace of the labor movement as well. So by the time the Green Party came together in 1992, progressive labor activists were very frustrated with the conservative direction that the previously much more progressive labor movement had taken, and many of them were at the first meeting of the Green Party of Rhode Island as well. In fact, in 2000, at the convention where Ralph Nader was nominated, the Green Party of Rhode Island was the only delegation in which every single delegate was a member of a union. In 1993, Greg Garrett and I had been tossing around the idea of reconfiguring the way we think about the Green Party in the United States and moving completely away from what Mike previously described as an anti-statist movement organization. Greg and I talked about this a lot. Greg can't be here today, but you might know Greg as the first Green candidate for any elective office in the United States. Wow. In 1986 as a candidate for the Assembly in Maine. He's now in Rhode Island and has been a leader of our party for a long time. But Greg and I wrote up the draft articles of confederation of what we called at the time a confederation of autonomous state Green Parties. Mike Feinstein had organized a Green Parties of the West gathering at Santa Monica. I went out to that with a stack of flyers and did some organizing and began pushing this idea of moving completely away from a very base-oriented, decentralized, but non-electoral and also non-statist organization, and recognizing that if Greens were ever to succeed in the United States, we would have to recognize that we were part of the American political culture. And the American political culture, beginning with those Articles of Confederation back in the 1700s, has always been decentralized, it's been localist, and it has been organized around a tremendous diversity of electoral and political laws, which meant if we were ever to have a national political party, it would have to be built brick by brick on the basis of 50 different sets of election laws, 50 different sets of citizenship requirements and political culture and so on. We wanted the Green Party in the United States to be embedded in American political culture, not foreign to American political culture. In retrospect, that seems quite obvious. But in the early 1990s, it was not so obvious. And many Green activists were dissidents, in the best meaning of the word, but also were outliers in American political culture. Very few of us had run for office in a serious way. And very few of us at that time had come out of any intensive political electoral experience in the Democratic or Republican Party. After being a political and electoral activist in Rhode Island for many years, it was clear to me that there was a very big difference between someone who had walked hundreds of streets and collected thousands of signatures and organized at the ward and the block level, and someone who had a vision for the future but had never done that hard grassroots electoral work. Well, Rhode Island, along with being the birthplace of industry, is probably also the birthplace of machine politics, and we were flush with people who had done grassroots ward level organizing. And it was not difficult in Rhode Island for us to envision a political party, a Green Party, which was not modeled after the Democratic and Republican parties, but acknowledged that there were some very important elements of the conventional American political parties that the Greens needed to replicate, if we were to succeed. We didn't get very far with that 1993 effort. Most of the people at the Santa Monica meeting were actually quite hostile to the idea of organizing ourselves around states and organizing ourselves around recognizing the diversity of state laws which govern political parties and govern elections. Now, of course, in retrospect, that we've tried to organize presidential elections, and we realize that one size does not fit all. The rules for getting on the ballot in Minnesota are completely different from the rules for getting on the ballot in Rhode Island, and in order to be successful, we would need to understand all of those different sets of political cultures, election laws, and rules. But it didn't take too long before the idea took root, so that by 1996, about the time that the California Greens were negotiating with Ralph Nader, Ralph came to Providence to give a lecture, and we prevailed on him to meet with the coordinating committee of the Green Party of Rhode Island after his lecture. He, as Ralph often does, spoke for about 9 hours, to his lecture. So we thought we would begin meeting with him about 7 or 8. We actually started the meeting at 11, and we met with Ralph until 3 o'clock in the morning. In a house built in the 1700s, the guest house at Brown University, and surrounded by the trappings of early American democracy, Ralph told us at that meeting that not only had he agreed to be on the ballot in California, but he would also willingly put his name on the ballot in Rhode Island, Colorado, and several other states, Maine, so that there are, I think, 5 states. By the time he left that meeting, he had agreed to be on the ballot in 5 states, and that was the beginning of the spread of the Ralph Nader campaign to the rest of the country. We were quite pleased, of course, that he announced at our private meeting with him that he was going to do something, and Mike is quite right. People had been badgering him for weeks from all of these states, give us an answer, give us an answer. And I mean, I suppose it's bad that he didn't directly answer the people in Colorado and Maine, but of course we got, as soon as we got home, we got on the phone and email, and it didn't take long for the word to spread that Ralph, in fact, was going to be a serious candidate in 1996. I want to just talk briefly about the 2000 Nader campaign, because a lot of very significant things happened there. I saw a lot of hands gone up earlier, 2000 or later, so I know a lot of you might have been brought into this party during the Nader campaign. Nader made 4 visits to Rhode Island during the 2000 campaign. In one of those, he gave a speech to about 600 people in the rotunda of our state house, surrounded by cannons from the Revolutionary War, statues from the Civil War, helmets and bayonets from the First World War, and copies of the early documents of the American democracy. Now, if you know Ralph, you know he loves that stuff. He just loves the idea that we are part of the American tradition. We're not somehow different from or foreign to the American tradition. Greens, in fact, are the best expression of traditional American political culture in the country today. We are the party that advocates for local politics, for decentralization, for direct democracy, for full participation. We are the only party in America today that really wants to actualize the promise of American democracy. We are absolutely the only political party. You know the Democrats and Republicans are getting farther and farther and farther away from those ideals of the American political culture. But Ralph wasn't the only one who came to Rhode Island. Winona also came to Rhode Island. And when Winona came to Rhode Island, she came for 2 days. And in some ways, this was a turning point for the campaign as well, because when Winona came to Rhode Island, her visit was co-hosted by the Narragansett Tribal Nation. It was the first time in the history of the Green Party that a tribal nation and a Green Party had cooperated on an electoral effort, certainly at the vice presidential level. So the Narragansett Tribal Police provided her security during the entire visit. Winona LaDuke was jetting up and down the highways in Rhode Island with the flashing lights and the Indian police chief as her driver. We had a banquet that evening. Winona was our guest of honor. And the head table was a tribal council member, Green Party candidate, tribal council member, Green Party candidate, Winona LaDuke, myself, the shaman, the medicine man of the Narragansett, Green Party candidate, all the way across the head table. And that had never happened before. Winona was given a gift from the Narragansetts. They made her a deerskin shawl with a horse tail tassel and an embroidered black crow, the totem of the Narragansetts. She put it on, she wrapped it around her shoulders, and she said, "I'm so happy to be here with the Green Party of Rhode Island and my people, and I feel like the Indian Queen of the Greens." And it was a fabulous moment. The Green Party of Rhode Island has placed our Green presidential candidate on the ballot in every election since 1996. There are very few Green parties in the country that have done that, every single election. We've run candidates for lieutenant governor, both houses of Congress. Yes, we only have two, but we've run candidates in both of them. State legislature, the House, the Senate, mayor of Providence, mayor of Woonsocket, city and town councils all over the state. But today, the Green Party of Rhode Island, for the last couple of years, has been much more involved in grassroots organizing and much less involved in electoral politics. We know the time will come. We'll get back in that game. But for the moment, we're doing something different, and I want to talk about what that is. In 2001, I was one of several people. Julia was in Canberra, John Rensenbrink, Mike Feinstein, Annie Gecki, who's not here. At the very first gathering of 70 Green parties from around the world in Canberra, Australia. And an interesting thing happened at that meeting. US Greens found ourselves allied not with the Europeans or the Australians or the New Zealand, but on vote after vote after vote. The Greens from the United States were voting with the delegates from Africa, the delegates from Latin America, the delegates from Scandinavia. This was true on votes on war and violence. It was true on gay rights. There was some dissension in Africa, but generally speaking, the Green Party of the United States was really, and I think this is a fair statement, was clearly identified as in the progressive wing of the global green movement. And this is still true today. The Greens in the US, Latin America, and Asia all worked together to support a position which condemned the World Trade Organization and condemned globalization and condemned free trade. And the people who opposed us were the Europeans. And the, well, for a variety of reasons, we don't need to talk about that now, but it was clear that there was a split in the global green movement. It wasn't enough to break it apart, but there was clearly an ideological and political split. The Europeans couldn't understand it. Nobody could. The Latin Americans couldn't understand it. Why are the Americans with us? They assumed that we would be with the Europeans. And a lot of it has to do with that grassroots identity that I'm talking about. Greens in the U.S. have been on the outs. Greens in the U.S. are dissidents. We have not been given an open door to government the way Greens in European countries have, by the electoral system. It's not that the European rulers want Greens in government, but they can't keep them out because of the way the proportional voting works. So because we are dissidents, because we have always been on the outside looking in, we still have a fresh and genuine and sincere sense of being different, of being of having a progressive vision, because we have not been given entree to the halls of power. We remain outside government in so many ways in this country. Now, the Greens in Rhode Island, today, we have worked in the last 2 years with the Occupy Wall Street movement, with the International Socialist Organization, the Workers' World Party, the Rhode Island Black Pack, the Rhode Island Latino Pack, women's organizations, neighborhood organizations, AIDS, and public health organizations, and so on. These alliances are what make the Green Party of Rhode Island what we are today. Not that we've run candidates or that we've won elections, but the fact that we have by far the best reputation and the best credibility of any organization on the progressive side of the political spectrum. In August of 2012, Jill's here, Jill remembers, we had a rally at Roger Williams National Memorial dedicated to the guy who founded Rhode Island on the principles of separation of church and state, individual liberty and conscience. And at that rally, which we call Jobs, Peace, and Planet, we had the entire progressive spectrum represented. People that don't work together ever. ISO and Workers' World, you know what I'm talking about? These are not friendly, this is not a friendly relationship. But they were both at our rally, they were both on stage, they both spoke. And they were there because the Greens were able to pull together an alliance that nobody had ever pulled together before in Rhode Island politics. We are the only political party that has ever had full support from the Occupy Wall Street activists in Rhode Island. Yeah. We Green Party members were at the occupation in Rhode Island. Now, where we are today. The Green Party of Rhode Island, you might know, recently spearheaded and organized a five-state alliance of Green parties, New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, Rhode Island, and Massachusetts, called the Green Alliance to Stop the Pipelines. We have built the first multi-state Green Party alliance ever. focused on an issue of fossil fuel and alternative energy development. And we have, I think, stumbled upon, because of who we are, the perfect issue for Greens, where the Democratic Party and the Republican Party both agree on a bridge fuel to nowhere. They both agree on all of the above. They both agree on the need to dig as much fracking gas out of the ground as possible and ship as much of it overseas as possible. The Greens are on the other side. Not just in Rhode Island, but all of the Green parties in the Northeast are absolutely opposed to the expansion of fracking gas pipelines because of the air pollution, because of the risk of explosions and destruction, the risk of forest fire and loss of life, and also the risk to the global climate, because we understand that natural gas is a bridge to nowhere. Natural gas is a more dangerous greenhouse component even than carbon dioxide. We don't want it, and we have put together a coalition which does two things. It gives Greens an opportunity to work together across state lines, and it also makes very clear to the public that the Democrats and Republicans are over here, and the Greens are over here, and the public is with us. This is one of the most important issues in modern American politics. The public is with us and not with the Democrats and Republicans. And we need to hammer that message home again and again and again. Finally, the people are coming. I can hear the footsteps. Can you?
No.
I can feel it. I can taste it. I can hear it. The people are coming our way. Every day, the American people are turning more and more towards the Greens on questions of ecology, equality, democracy, and peace. The American public is coming our way. We need to prepare. We need to be ready. Remember, some of you are old enough, many of you are old enough, to remember that first Whole Earth photograph, Christmas Eve, 1968. The first time the people of the world could see ourselves in the mirror. We didn't see any national boundaries. We didn't see religions. We didn't see races. We saw beautiful marble spinning in space, surrounded by absolute terrifying blackness as far as the eye could see. And I believe that moment of seeing the whole Earth was a turning point in human history, because now for the first time we could see that we're all in this together and there's no place else to go. The Greens are the only party in the world that has the vision and the clarity to bring that vision of a whole Earth community into being. And I hope all of you will leave this convention absolutely committed to being ready when the American people finally turn away from the gray parties and become Greens by the millions.
Thank you so much, Tony. Very inspiring. Next, we'd like to pause for a special presentation. And I'm going to ask Vanessa Vogel, a up-and-coming leader in the Green Party of St. Paul, I think was chair of the party here, to lead this. Welcome.
Well, thank you so much. As Cam said, my name is Vanessa Vogel, and I was one of the chairs of the local St. Paul Green Party, 4th Congressional District of Minnesota. And I just want to thank everyone for coming here. It's wonderful to see this kind of a gathering of Greens. So I'm going to invite, I have a few words to say, but I'm going to invite Rhoda Gilman to kind of make her way up here. Anniversary of the founding of the Green Party here in Minnesota, we thought it would be a great opportunity to celebrate one of the founding mothers and a true pillar of the Green Party movement, Minnesota's very own Rhoda Gilman. We are lucky that Rhoda has dedicated so much of her energy and talent to the Green Party. She joined the Twin Cities Greens not long after that first meeting here at Macalester, and she was instrumental in organizing the Green Party of Minnesota just about 20 years ago. She was the Green Party candidate for Lieutenant Governor in Minnesota alongside Ken Pentel in 2002. I think there's some signs around here. Sorry, I think the mic's kind of gone again, but
no, you need to just speak
Speak right into it. Okay. She has most recently served as a spokesperson for the St. Paul Green Party, which is how I've come to know her. Rhoda is a gifted historian. She is the reason that we have an archive for the Green Party at the Minnesota Historical Society. She is also an accomplished author. Her work includes a biography about Minnesota's first governor called Henry Hastings Sibley, Divided Heart. She also wrote an important textbook about the history of Minnesota called The Story of Minnesota's Past. And most recently, she published a history of protest politics in Minnesota called Stand Up, The Story of Minnesota's Protest Tradition. And I encourage all of you to read some of those books if you haven't already. As you can see, Rhoda's wisdom and sharp wit are an invaluable asset to the Green Party. I know that personally, she, for all these reasons, she's an inspiration to me. She makes me proud to be a Green, and I imagine that is true for many of us in this room. So it is with my great honor and pleasure to present Rhoda with this token of our appreciation. We had a plaque put together for all things she's done for the Green Party. And it reads, presented with sincere appreciation to Rhoda Gilman for her many years of dedication and service to the Green Party in Minnesota in commemoration of the 30th anniversary of the founding of the Green Movement, from the 4th Congressional District, St. Paul Green Party. So thank you.
I want to thank Vanessa and my fellow Greens. It will no doubt be a relief to you. I have not prepared a speech. I, as a matter of fact, I asked specifically not to have to speak, but here I am. And in some ways, that's how I got into politics. I sort of backed my way into it. I guess I do want to be sure that my fellow Greens in Minnesota and throughout the nation understand how humbled I feel by getting an award like this and by being honored by the movement that I honor above all others. And there's a lot more that I could say about the growth of the Minnesota Greens and also about the importance of preserving our history as a party and as a movement. I want to emphasize that. If I have made a real contribution at all to the Green Movement, I think it's in insisting that we try to keep our history, because it's a an old saying, of course, a tired old saying that we all stand on the shoulders of those who have gone before. And so again, I want to thank you. I am really humbled by this. I'm humbled by all the work that previous speakers have testified to that has gone on in the past 30 years and before, because the Green Movement didn't spring to life without a seedbed of a fertile movement and feeling for the earth before it even came into existence. Thank you very much.
We are so fortunate to have Rhoda with us. I appreciate that. I encourage folks to move up if you're having difficulty hearing. We heard some more comments about that, and I realize that actually moving up might have some other side benefits, like we can get a little more comfortable with one another. And we have a couple more speakers. There's a chance we have a little time for some questions if we want to afterwards. But I would like to introduce our second to the last speaker. This is the co-founder of the Maine Green Party and the Green Party of the United States, author of two histories of the Green Party, The Greens and the Politics of Transformation, and Against All Odds, and also a Minnesota native, John Rensenbrink. Hi there.
Hey.
Are you still vaguely awake?
Yes. Maybe should be.
I shouldn't say that. I shouldn't really say that. But no reflection on the previous speaker, but they did take a long time. But I know Tony pretty well, and I know Mike pretty well, and I know Greta pretty well. And I also know the person who spoke least, Rhoda Gilman. I'm so very happy and pleased, Gilman, Rhoda, that I know I've met you in Milwaukee back in 2004, but you and I have been together by correspondence and by similar spirit for a long, long time. And I know she backed me a lot in one of the difficult days that we had in the early days of the.
Do you want to take this out?
Yeah.
That might be a little easier.
Maybe so. Anyway, she's on my board for the Green Horizon magazine, and a stellar member of my board, and I'm so very proud to have you. A lot of things I could tell you, and many of the things you already know, probably all of them from the previous speakers. Now, there are some things that I want to convey to you tonight. I grew up here in Minnesota on a dairy farm 60 miles north of here, and eventually moved to Maine, which reminds me of Minnesota a lot. And I think that Minnesota and Maine have a lot in common, as Minnesota and Maine have in common with Rhode Island and with a lot of other states. And I think that we have a way of thinking about the world that brings us back to reality. And one of the things that's most important about reality is to find our way and to understand where we are. I don't know whether we Greens have yet really found our way where we are. I think it's an issue of identity. It's been an issue ever since we started. Back there, I know when we started in Maine 8 months before we started in St. Paul, and we had a problem at that time of identity of who we really were. Were we just Black Tillandsers or Great Black Tillandsers, or were we sort of modeling ourselves as the Democratic Party? That was an issue. And we split on that. And we came back together and decided that we were going to be trying to be both. We're going to be a party and a movement. And I think that whole meaning of what being a party and a movement is part of our whole question of identity. It's true we have grown up out of the social movements, as Greta Gaard has pointed out so well. At the same time, maybe we've lost something in that. Not so much lost, but avoided or eluded something in that. And that is, in some ways, taken up by the fact that we must be electoral in our politics as well as movement in our politics. But it seems to me, in terms of identity. In our early days, for example, in Maine, we were always asked, well, oh, you know, you're great what you're trying to do, but actually, are you any different from the Democrats? And you sort of have answers to that and so on. But I think the thing that most pulled me together with Howie Hawkins, even though we fought bitterly, well, bitterly, I'm not sure. But nevertheless, Howie Hawkins and I, he was with the Left Green Network, and I helped invent the global green green politics network, and we were sort of on opposite sides. I wrote this in my book about Against All Odds. But one thing that really established a commonality between me and Howie and between all of us, and that is that we were really determined, as I think Tony has alluded to and all the speakers have, we were determined that we were going to be independent. And the meaning of what it means to be independent is what I want to talk about. Because the meaning of being independent at that time really meant to differentiate ourselves from the Democrats and Republicans. But what does that really mean? Well, since that time, the world has changed since 1984 when we started. And though we had fantastic ideas at that time and great enthusiasm and great plans, we hadn't really been tested. We haven't really been asked
to check it out with the American people as to who we are. And that always at that time and since that time, have we really faced up to that in the end, what we want to do is change the power structure? Have we faced up to the notion that in the end, we want to be a party of a different kind in the system and yet not of it? I'm going to be talking about that a lot on Saturday with David Cobb, but I just want to briefly voice some of that. Being independent right now has got a lot more meaning than it did back in 1984. One of the reasons is that the world has changed, the United States government has changed. The United States government is now in this post-Clinton and post-Bush and post-Obama era. The United States government has become simply the prey of a rather dreadful oligarchy. We all know that. But it's more than that. It's the fact that the oligarchy is flooding, with the help of the Supreme Court, is flooding our politics with money. And that money is everywhere. And that money intrudes itself into everything. And it intrudes itself into who we are and what we are, and intrudes itself into the very best Democrats you can think of. You got to think about that. And by contrast, as the speakers have told you, and we can all tell ourselves, we did a very, very important and terribly, terribly, vital thing, and a difficult, dangerous thing in some ways. We eschewed, if that's the word, we said we would not take corporate money. And since that time, I remember also when Clinton first made his move towards centrist democracy. Well, what that really was, that was telling his fellow Democrats to embrace corporate money. That's what that was all about. And since that time, both the Republicans and the Democrats have outdone each other, to, with the help of the Supreme Court again, to make politics into a greedy feeding ground for people with oligarchic sentiments, not only, but with imperialist sentiments and with ecological denial, meaning exponential growth. So what we have is a system that now we are in. I'm looking at Jill. We're in it, Jill. We're in that system, and yet we are also not of it, because it's very clear that we don't take corporate money. Now, there are a lot of other things that we don't do, or that we do that is different. And Tony has mentioned a lot of that, and Mike has mentioned a lot of that, and Greta has mentioned that, because I think Greta, for example, her comments about feminism are really, really profound, and all the implications of that. But in the end, we are people who decided to do the awesome thing of finding ourselves in a situation where we want power. Power, P-O-W-E-R. And that means getting people elected. And that's an awesome kind of thing. And to get people elected in spite of or besides or in spite of, in the absence of any kind of money. We have no money. In Maine, I don't know about you guys in your states, but we have no money. We can't bring people from Maine here because we have no money. And it's tough. And I think, as Tony has indicated, I have the same feeling he has, that he ended with. I do think that it's coming, but it won't come, folks, unless we have lots of candidates. I think we have to really stress that. We have to keep plugging away and winning. We have to keep plugging away and winning in the sense of winning people's confidence that we really are different. And a big key to me is that at the local level, where people are asked to vote for candidates that are green, they do. These are for nonpartisan races, right? And for nonpartisan races, they. And one of the reasons is that they see their fellow citizens as greens going door to door and talking to them. And so we have lots and lots of people running at the local level who have the sense of talking to people, shoring up people's ideas about who we are, and showing also to people that we are people of a different kind, and we are going for this kind of what they would regard as a somewhat idealistic way of asking people to vote for them. And they don't vote for us. Why don't they vote for us? Because they are used to voting for the Republicans or the Democrats. And they are used to hearing the propaganda of the Democrats and Republicans about us Greens. So one answer to that has been, well, let's become more electoral. Let's be like the other parties. And that's one answer. And it's something that I think affects quite a few people in the Green Party. The other answer has been, of course, we have nothing more to do with electoral politics. It's bullshit. It's corrupt. And let's not have anything more to do with it. We're doing both. We're doing both. We're not just fighting the system as we did in the 60s. And we're not just going outside the system and building, you know, for the future at the social and cultural level. We're doing both. And we are, oh man, I am so proud of everybody in this room. I am so damn proud of the fact that we have the courage and the guts to be the kind of people who are willing to get out there, and like Jill has done and shown us so much, to get out there and run well, and carry the message. And at the same time, never allowing ourselves to be diverted from that feeling. You know what? It's true. People say, well, we have said, for example, and I heard Nader say this, and other people have said this time and again, well, you know, our values, green values, are the values of America. And in a way, that's true. But in a sense, it's not yet true, because they don't vote for us. And we've got to break into that whole issue of they're not voting for us because they are, for a number of reasons, not all of which are the result of other people's fault or the system's fault, partly because we have not been consistent. We have not been really pushing hard. And I'm saying that if people at the local level, again and again, and this is certainly true in California, certainly true in Ohio, certainly true in Maine, certainly true, I think, in most states, where at the local level we are running nonpartisan races very successfully, getting in office and showing that we are Greens in a very, very serious and unconventional but American way. But the thing is, we have to continue doing that again and again and again until we break through. I say to you, Tony, and all the rest of us, yeah, it's great, I feel it coming, but it ain't gonna come until we act on it. It ain't gonna come until we have lots of candidates who are willing to do this. It's a tremendous, awesome thing to ask people to do that again and again, to go out there on the hustings. It's exciting, it's good, and eventually, when we run people for partisan office, for state legislature, Congress, and president, that we will eventually get their vote. I think we will. It's 30 years since we started this thing, folks. It's going to take another 30 years. Don't stare at me aghast at that. Within 10 years, we'll see the momentum. In another 20 years, we'll really see the momentum. Because of course it's going to go. Ecology and economy are twins. Opposite sides of the same coin. Nonviolence is the way to go. Grassroots democracy, which we own, is of course the way to go. Have I missing it? And of course, all the parties have completely abandoned social justice. And social justice is our thing as well. So we have those big four. Ecology that is also economy. We have grassroots democracy. We have nonviolence. And we have, am I missing anything? Social justice, and those big four. But of course, along with it, we have a belief in economy that's that is centered on the community, and diversity, and global thinking. I could talk a long time, but I'm going to stop. I'm getting tired. But my dear friends, I just want to emphasize again, don't forget that our identity is gradually emerging. It's getting inside our guts and our feelings and our skin and so on. So that is natural. It becomes not just a sort of a nice thing to have, but it's something that's just part of us. And that's the glorious thing about, I feel, in 30 years of momentum building. So let's go. Go we go.
Well, lastly, I'd like to ask Bud Dickinson, Secretary of the Green Party of the United States, to make a few comments.
Thank you. I'm going to come out front here. Be with you all. So for the last 3 years, I have been the Secretary of the Green Party of the United States. Member of the nine-member steering committee, and that's an experience in itself. because we're still struggling with each other, and I have a long history. It goes way back to 1980. Or even to 1972 with George McGovern. 1980, I was with Mark Satin, a name that hasn't been mentioned tonight. Mark wrote a book, New Age Politics, which influenced me. And then he started the New Age Alliance. So I worked with him in DC with the New Age Alliance. And so then John did not mention the SPACA process, which I really enjoyed. It was our first, quote, platform process. And it stood for strategy and policy approaches in key areas, SPACA. So we wrote a long document and a very grassroots process, and we had three meetings, what I used to call the three E's, Eugene, Estes Park, Colorado, and Elkins, West Virginia. I was at all those meetings, as I've been to all our annual meetings of this organization. Elkins was where the split happened between GPUSA and what ended up as the Green Party of the United States. So I have a big box of memorabilia at home, but I've been so involved in the last couple of years with the current struggles that that box of memorabilia stayed in the closet. And I'm motivated by this gathering here to deal with our current struggles. I get enmeshed in personalities. We have a lot of independent personalities, if you might want to put it, in this party. We are all question authority people. So what do we do? How do we work together? We've got to work together. We've got to get beyond our personalities, find forgiveness, find a way to work cooperatively, struggle, and then work together. And I hope our future and the 1 year left I have on my term as secretary
we can work together and move this party forward. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I apologize that our sound system wasn't better. Hopefully, we were able to hear most of that and get most of this information. Clearly, there's an amazing history to what we've been doing, and now here we are today and tomorrow and the next day to see where we are, and I think we all hope and believe and are willing to work hard to make a big future out of it all for us, and I appreciate that. I do want to invite the speakers and the award recipients to come up for a photograph. That's a great idea that Mike had, and so that we can kind of capture this. I think that would be fantastic. And I'm going to let the rest of you then just be free to discuss and mingle and share stories, maybe talk about your first experience with the Greens and what you what you remember about that amongst yourselves. And thank you so much for your attention, and look forward to seeing you more tomorrow and the next day.